Thank you so much for coming tonight. Robert Kiyosaki, the author of Rich Dad, Poor Dad, said once that the biggest difference between the rich and the poor is how they spend their time. And I really commend you guys. It's not nice out there, and you guys braved the stormy weather to come out and improve your financial IQ and really learn some great strategies tonight that will help you build a pension. So, yeah, kudos to you guys. My name is Johanna Armstrong. I'm the owner of Island Life Financial, and I see a lot of new faces here tonight, so that is really great. If I didn't get a chance to introduce myself, I'd love to do that after the event. We will be around to answer questions. But my background is a little odd. I used to be a massage therapist for 10 years, and 5 years ago, I did a completely switch around, and I just love finances because I found out that, you know, I could massage people every week and they'd just get all stressed out again. And after talking to them, you know, you get to talk to people a lot when you massage them for an hour. I'd find out their biggest stress was money. So if I could really help the underlying problem and help them understand money better, I thought I could make a bigger difference with these people. So that's my passion. I am all about abundance. And what I want for you is that you have enough wealth so that you can enjoy your life and live the island life. So that's where I came up with the name. Whatever that is for you, that you have freedom and you're loving your life and not worrying about your money, because you only get one go around, right? So you guys met my business partner, Dave. Oh, you want to come up here, Dave? I'll just introduce you quickly here. He's going to be presenting the second part here, but just briefly, you can talk about your background.
Brief. I'm retired now. and Joanna enticed me to join her, which was great because she's helped me out about 5-6 years ago. She showed me about the exempt market and showed me the way in which I can utilize my biggest asset, my house, and invest in a way that I'm comfortable now. So I like sharing because I used to be a teacher. I used to be an auditor. Don't worry, not CRA. And I also work with the pension plan. And with the BC pension plan, I heard about the exempt market a long time ago, but I never decided to learn what it was until Joanne explained to me. That's pretty silly because I actually worked there, and they did do a lot of investing, and they start investing more. But that's who I am. I've done many, many different things, and I hope I can share my experiences and help you all out as well. That's just sort of the teacher coming out of me because I've done full circle. I started off as a teacher in a private school, and now I'm coming around, and I enjoy teaching. So that's
perfect. Thanks, Dave.
I'm doing. Oh, yeah, we're not sharing tonight.
Yeah, for those of you who were here 2 weeks ago, we had a presentation, and we were sharing a mic, so now we don't have to do the relay race. The main thing I want you guys to understand out of tonight is that the game has changed. If you think you understand or you're trying to invest the way that your parents did or your grandparents, it is not the same game anymore. And so what I'm about is finding out-of-the-box thinking financial strategies that are different than what you're going to hear about at the bank, okay? And it's, I have to say, this strategy here tonight that we're talking about with Gord Johnson changed my life. Last year, I'm self-employed. I didn't think I'd be able to buy a house. The banks wanted a 35% down payment, and I'm just not willing to tie up that much money in a house. So through this strategy, it just blew open all possibilities, and I was able to buy a house. I live there for free, and I work out of it. It's just a dream come true. So there's many ways to implement the strategy, but he'll be talking about that in a minute. So basically, the main game changer is that the historical interest rates have really come down. Who here was investing in the 80s? Anybody? Lucky. You could have your money in the bank making 16%. Wouldn't that be great? You know, everybody was a good investor when interest rates are 16%. Not so cool. Who had a mortgage in those years? Yeah. It's not good timing at all, right? So since the 1980s, it's been going down. This chart ends in 2012. It's been going down even lower. And if you are trying to live on your savings at 2% interest to make $25,000 income, you need $1.25 million. $25,000 isn't very much income. And that's a lot of money if you're just trying to make it on a GIC, or I'm not even sure you can get GICs at 2%. So that whole game of just keeping your money in the bank isn't working. And what is the future trend? Well, these are some headlines in the newspaper. There's currently 15 countries that have negative interest rates in the world. What does that mean? Like, you put your money in the bank, guaranteed to come out with less? I think we kind of have that already here. It's called fees, but I definitely spend more at my bank than I get. So this is CNBC, and Canada could adopt negative interest rates within the next 2 years. So saving your money and earning interest at the bank no longer works. The Fed has killed the saver. So this, you know, what used to work is just you work hard, you save your money, and eventually one day you're rich and you can retire and live off your savings. Not so anymore. Low interest rates help private equity moguls and hurt the average American. So today, the near zero rates are free money for investors, but murder for savers and retirees. So what I'd like to show you today is how to become one of these private equity moguls. Who'd like to be a private equity mogul? Who even knows what that means? Well, we'll explain what private equity is, because it's quite a different game than what you might have traditionally heard at the banks. But tonight is just about learning the rules to this new game. So I'm really excited about teaching you about that. So without further ado, please, I want to introduce our first guest speaker. It's Gordon Johnson. He is the author of Turn Your Mortgage into a Pension. And I'm going to let him introduce himself. So please put your hands together for Gordon Johnson.
Tonight I want to take you a little bit through my journey and to how I actually came up with the concept and why I came up with the concept. It wasn't something I sat down one day and decided I need to write a book. It wasn't something I decided I need to go out and start teaching people anything in specific. But what it did come about was my own frustration with where we were at that point in our life. Now, before I'm sure most of you have seen these before. I think the professional term of this is they're a weasel clause. The lawyers make us say, basically, I am not licensed to this part of any of the products that we talk about are going to be talked about by the people who are licensed. I am not. I'm simply an educator. Any of the information that's done tonight is strictly for education purposes. Well, let's start off and I'll introduce you to a couple of friends of mine. This is Leroy and Jethro. Now, Leroy and Jethro are small farmers. They worked hard, but they never quite seemed to get ahead. I think we can often relate to that. Well, one day they came up with a brilliant idea. They said, you know what, if we could buy a pony, we could rent that pony out. We could take it to birthday parties. We could lend it out to people who wanted to haul, you know, a little wagon with their kids. We can make some money. So they looked around, they found one for $100. And they thought, well, that's not a bad deal. So they made the arrangement with the farmer. They bought the pony, made an arrangement, said, next week we'd like you to bring it to our property. We've got to do a little bit of fencing and make sure it doesn't run away. Well, the next Saturday, a dump truck rolls up. Well, they were a bit surprised. They were expecting to have this pony delivered in, you know, a horse trailer at least. The dump truck rolls up, lifts up, and out rolls this dead pony. Well, they weren't very happy. And they immediately said, you sold us a dead pony. And the farmer said, no, actually, I didn't. I sold you a live pony, but it died this last week. So technically, you own the pony. You know, my job is to deliver it. If you would like me to haul it away, I can do that for another $25. And they scratched your head and said, you know what? We spent our last dollar trying to get this pony. We're trying to get ahead. Well, sometimes our investment life feels like that. Sometimes we think we make a good investment. We've done our research. We put out all the money we have, and it goes south. And we think, oh, you know, that typical, you know, I'm going to stop investing. I know I tried it. It doesn't work. I've had it. Well, they had enough experience in farming to realize that if you can get creative And if you can think things a little differently and have somewhat of a paradigm shift, maybe you actually can make what would appear to be a bad investment into something good. So they put their heads together and they came up with the idea of holding a raffle. So they printed 500 tickets at $2 a piece. They sold the tickets out, raffled off the horse. And they actually did quite well. Yeah, this is his pony. So the next week, they're in town, and they're going to the bank to put in their money. And they're pulling out their money and put it in there. And the farmer who sold them the pony said, hey, did whatever do with that pony? And they said, hey, you know what? Thank you very much. It worked out really well. We actually netted $898. He said, well, how the heck did you make that kind of money off a dead pony? He said, well, it was quite simple. We printed 500 raffle tickets, $2 a piece. We sold them all. He said, well, just a minute here. He said, what about the guy that won the pony? Oh, no, he was really angry. We gave him his $2 back. So now that's quite a paradigm shift that can show that sometimes you can actually get creative. Now, I wasn't quite that lucky. I've been in financial services now for 39 years. I came into it right out of university. I've done various types of, I've actually been an international financer. I've worked in the private equities. My father and I owned a life insurance managing general agent. I had a contract bonding company. So I've done a lot of different things within the financial arena and consider myself fairly knowledgeable. I'd done the securities course. I had my chartered financial planning degree. Had a number of other designations as well as for investments. But I never actually felt comfortable with what I was taught. I'm always a little bit thinking outside the box. And my father retired in 1992. We sold off the company at that point. He retired to Parksville. I sold out my shares in the company then as well. I had another company which I sold out 2 years later. But once the main sort of thrust of the company was gone, it was time for me kind of to move on. So we moved down to the Lower Mainland. Well, house prices have not always gone up, you know, contrary to popular belief right now. When we moved down to Vancouver, prices were actually going backwards. We had a very nice house in Prince George. It was a beautiful house on the Greenbelt. There's nothing behind us except great cross-country ski trails. We sold it for $135,000. We moved to Vancouver. We rented in Sunshine Hills in a house that wasn't even close to the house that we had left. And it was for sale for $375,000 and going backwards. Now, in retrospect, it was a good deal. But at the time, I'm thinking, if I bought this place, I would have to take out a mortgage that's double pretty well what I sold my house for. And it's going backwards. Why would I want to do that? Why do I want to wipe out my equity? We rented for 10 years. It wasn't until the end of 2003, early 2004, that the market finally turned. When we bought again, it was when I was 49 years old. Well, traditional financial planning doesn't tell you to start getting into the housing market at age 49. Your house then is paid off, traditionally, sometime in the mid-70s, the late 70s. Well, the interesting was I was teaching financial planning at that time. And what I'm teaching is certainly not working for us. Because we're literally starting over in a brand new market with a house, huge mortgage. We had two kids in university. I had an investment loan. We were making good income, and we were struggling. And what I noticed was that when I was dealing with the brokers that I was teaching at the time, they were quite broke as well. And one of the main reasons they were broke was dealing with clients who couldn't afford to do anything. They would meet with them, they would do a great financial analysis for them, and say, what you need is more life insurance, you need some critical illness insurance, you need to start putting money away for your registered retirement savings plan to try to look after your retirement. And the typical answer was, let me think about it. The real answer was, are you kidding? $500 a month? If it was 50, I would struggle. We're living in the Lower Mainland. We're living paycheck to paycheck. We've got kids in university. We've got car loans. We're paying huge gas prices. They don't have the money. And I thought, you know what? I'm exactly the same position. Partly because we started getting into the housing market at such a late time. Well, being the rogue that I typically was, I said, I'm going to have to look outside of my traditional training. because the traditional training where I had was through life insurance companies, through banks, through mutual fund companies, securities, and it wasn't giving me the answers I wanted. So I felt like this gentleman here. He's got this puzzle together. He's got a picture of retirement. Maybe it's island life. Maybe it's someplace in the Bahamas. But he has this great picture of when he, remember the old ads, Freedom 55? Okay. They don't play those anymore. and that's about when I was starting. But the old Freedom 55 showed this wonderful couple going off in the sunset at age 55 because they had started much earlier. I think possibly at age 0 or 1. But I was in that situation as well from the training. And we have this picture of retirement. And I felt like you dump the pieces on the table and they just don't fit. You know, this picture starts to come together, but maybe some of the pieces are the wrong size, or they're the wrong color, or the wrong shape, and it just doesn't seem to come together. And that's what I was feeling. And I started going out to seminars. I read Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and that was an eye-opener. I read a number of other books. I started going to seminars that were put on by, one of the first ones I went to was by the Trump Organization. It was awful. It was probably one of the worst seminars I've ever been to. Did you go to that too? Well, aren't they wonderful? Basically, hi, welcome. If you think you're learning tonight, forget it. You need to sign up for my $10,000 course. You know? So now you know how Trump got rich. But I started picking up little pieces here and there, and it started to make the puzzle fit a little better. Now, it's very difficult to change habits. And we hear that. And I congratulate tonight for coming out. One of the hardest habits we have to change is our way of thinking. Now, I learned in the last month how difficult it is to change a habit. And a month ago, I was working out at the gym, and I managed to strain my rotator cuff. I don't know if you've ever had that pleasure before. It was an eye-opener. I didn't know I'd done it right away. A couple days later, I woke up with a throbbing pain in my, basically, everywhere it moved. And I went to get some help, and which has helped greatly, but it's still quite sore. But the biggest adjustment is I have slept my whole life on my right side. And that's the shoulder that was bothering me. I couldn't sleep. So I had to flip around to the left side. I can't sleep on my left side. I have trained myself my whole life to sleep on my right side. I don't know why. Maybe I read someplace that you squish your heart and you die at night. I'm not sure, but I had to sleep, and I woke up every hour on the hour, and I was trying to roll back, and it would pain, I'd flip back. Well, by the end of the first week, I was absolutely exhausted. And now I'm into the third week. I'm still exhausted, but it's getting a little better. But again, that's the whole change of habit. You know, when you sleep so long on one side, and you know now you have to switch, and you have to do something better, it's not easy. I'm looking forward to a good night's sleep again. But one thing that really stuck out to me especially was our cash flow. All my training had taught me to build a nest egg, had taught me to look for long-term investments, to build this nest egg, so at this magic age of 65, we can now create some income. Robert Kiyosaki said, wait a minute, that's not very smart. We don't retire at 65, we retire when we create cash flow that pays our monthly expenses. Well, that was completely foreign to me. And completely foreign to the type of investments I had at the time, and completely foreign to what I was teaching the brokers in financial planning. And I was mentoring other people as well. And it just really struck me as something quite different. And I didn't have any idea at that point how to create cash flow, except possibly through investing in real estate. Well, I mean, we just finally got in our house. You know, we weren't in a position to invest in real estate. So I started to look and start to think about how am I actually going to create cash flow. And I was sitting in the office one day, I work out of the house, and my wife walked in. And I turned to her and said, Jan, I said, do you realize that if you and I both quit our job today, our income goes to zero tomorrow? Well, she gave me this very confused, like, is this a trick question? she said, well, that is why we work. I said, yeah, but isn't it sad? Isn't it sad that we've been working now for 30 years and we have investments, but they don't pay us any cash flow at all? They're all designed to this magic history point, some year in the future that we can maybe convert it into cash. I said, isn't it sad that we have not learned how to create capital that actually pays us cash flow today? And she said, well, that sounds great, Gord. How are we going to do that? And I said, I haven't got a clue. None of the training that I have had will actually teach you how to do that. And I said, but I'm going to find out. I'm going to do some research outside of my traditional training. I'm going to look, go to more seminars, going to read more books. Basically, I was trying to put her off and figure that at some point in the future, I would actually learn. Well, a number of seminars did teach me a few little tidbits here and there. It allowed me to put something together. And over time, I developed enough of a strategy for myself, which I'm going to talk about a bit tonight. And I wrote the book, Turn Your Mortgage into a Pension, which became a number one Amazon bestseller the month it was released, and has hit number one every month in the last year and a half. So it is striking a chord with people. And as Johanna has mentioned as well, it's teaching people a different paradigm shift. And that's what we want to do with the book. We're not giving all the answers. We're simply saying, look at things a little different. Look at things that might, you know, tweak the way you're doing things or might have a way. To me, I didn't have this aha moment. I had lots of little aha moments along the way. And each one kind of built on the previous one. It kept building and kept building and kept building until finally I could say, okay, I now have a strategy. And I was the only person using the strategy because I wanted to see if it worked. And it started to work very well. So I started to teach it to some of the brokers that I was mentoring. And they started going out and teaching it. And then I started putting on seminars. Some of the people kept saying, you know, we love what you're teaching, but we forget 90% of it. Could you put it in writing for us? And I said, well, possibly, but I don't consider myself a writer. I had done some journal articles for the industry, but this was a completely different type of effort. Fortunately, my wife, who is a major in linguistics, and of her own admission is a financial moron, was a wonderful editor. Because she said, after reading the book, she said, Gord, this is the first time in my life I think I know what you actually do. So it's, but the whole purpose of the book was I could put it on paper, but when you're in the industry a long time, we use a lot of words that we think are very common, they're not. And that scares a lot of people from reading books. Well, honestly, most financial books are quite boring anyway, but quite apart from that, there's a lot of words that they get confused and they don't want to slog through. And my daughter, she's an English major, she's an assistant librarian, she was the other editor. I sent her a copy of the transcript and she phoned me and said, Dad, you need a glossary. And I said, why? I said, I made it very simple. She said, Dad, I don't understand all kinds of words in there. So I said, well, why don't you circle the words you don't understand? And I'm thinking, maybe here, maybe 6 pages later, you know, maybe every other chapter. She butchered it. I don't think there was a page that probably had more than at least 6 to 8, maybe even 10 circles. Words like net assets, mortgage, amortization. These were words that were so common to me. I immediately got on the phone and said, don't you understand what net assets are? She said, no. She said, Dad, you've mentioned that my whole life, but you never once explained it to me. And I said, and amortization doesn't ring a bell? She said, well, it rings a bell. You talk about it all the time, but I don't know what it is. You never stop to explain it. And I thought, and another light came on. I thought, isn't this sad that we as an industry will go out and try to teach people using words that they don't understand? And that, I think, is a huge barrier to a lot of people picking up financial books, and it's a huge barrier for them actually doing anything. And this is often what ends up happening, because they stick their head in the sand, and this lady, it looks like a lot of fun, but I don't believe this was her goal at retirement. But it probably, unfortunately, for a lot of people, it's either here or, you know, at Walmart greeting. Now, this is an interesting fact. When I ask people typically, and I did last week at a seminar, I've given you the answers. I'm not going to ask you the question, but if you ask people, what do you think the Canada pension plan is? I had a room of about 20 people, not one of them was even close. And they were all there was two younger people there. Most of them were in their 40s and 50s. None of them had a clue. And I thought, you know what? You are getting ready in the next 10 or 15 years to actually retire. You don't know what the maximum is. I said, the maximum now in 2016 has just been increased to $1,092.50 a month. That is if you have paid in your maximum for basically 30, 35 years. The average that's paid out is $629.33. Now, part of the reason the average is lower as well is a lot of people will take their retirement pension at what age?
60,
absolutely. Because they get the opportunity and they take it. When they do, they reduce it by 30%. That's now going up to 36%. Now, if you even qualified for, you know, let's say $900 a month, if you take it at age 60, you're getting $600 a month. And that is not a great retirement. So I was looking at my own situation. Now, being self-employed, we tend to, I don't know if we say we dislike CRA more than the average person, but we certainly don't really relish all the extra stuff we have to pay. And one of them is a self-employed person actually has to pay double CPP. When you're working for a company, the company pays half and the employee pays half. When you're self-employed, we pay the whole shot. So what we do, as much as we can, is reduce our income as low as possible to pay the least tax and the least CPP. Well, guess what happens to our pension? We don't qualify for the max. We qualify, and that's true of a lot of self-employed people. Okay, let's shift gears a little bit now. When we're talking about paying off a mortgage, most of us have mortgages, how we buy houses. Long, long are gone the days when you could save up enough to buy a house. We pay a mortgage off over 25 or 30 years. Now, just a quick question here. If we have a $250,000 mortgage, what do you think it's going to cost to pay it off? $400?
Depends on the interest rate.
There's a few things it depends on. Depends on interest rate. It depends on your amortization period. One more thing. Down payment, possibly. Something we typically don't think about is what tax bracket are we in? We pay our mortgage after we pay our taxes. Before you get your paycheck, Revenue Canada takes their chunk. What you're left with is what you pay your mortgage with. So the higher tax bracket you are, the more you're actually going to pay for your house. So for those of us who've worked really hard to keep our tax bracket low, we may not get as much of a pension, but we don't pay as much for our house either. So now, here we're showing a $250,000 mortgage. We're talking here about an average tax bracket of 20% and an interest rate of 4% over the life of the mortgage. Now, in order to pay that $250,000 mortgage off, before we get the money to pay it, we have to give Revenue Canada $97,500. And then we pay the bank another $140,000. What it costs is $487,500. Now, that's a bit of a shock. When you look at, basically, you're paying pretty well double for the mortgage, and a bit of a shock to, say, myself when I'm starting to, you know, looking at a mortgage at age 49 and saying, okay, by the time I pay this thing off, I'm well into my 70s, and I'm going to be paying an awful lot of money for it. Well, the two problems here are taxes and our compound interest. So how can we possibly save for our retirement on top of paying for a mortgage if your mortgage is going to be $500,000? And the government says, okay, you pay off your mortgage of $500,000, plus you put into CPP, and you should, and then top of that, look after yourself for retirement by putting money into an RSP or making other investments, which is very unlikely. Matter, it's interesting. In the last week on MSN, there was a headline that was done, I believe, by wasn't the Fraser Institute, one of the other ones that said the average savings between 45 and 55 for retirement for people making between 25 and 50,000 a year. What do you think it was? Anybody see that article? $250. I thought it was a misprint at first. They said for the average person between 45 and 55 making between 25 and 50,000 a year, their average retirement is $250. If they are making between $50,000 and $100,000 a year, it's $21,000. Now, that's not even close to setting up for retirement. Now, if we can redirect some of the money. Now, this is just a, is this a focus? I didn't think it was either. I thought my eyes are going here. Okay. but if I directed it to the red here, if you want to create a $1,000 a month income by generating 5% interest, you need to accumulate $240,000. Now, whether that's in registered funds like RRSPs or in TFSAs or in other investments, you have to create $240,000 at 5% to create an additional $1,000 a month. Oh, that's much better. Thank you. I woke up. now, how easy is it to collect $240,000 on top of paying off a $500,000 mortgage, on top of paying for kids' education, on top of buying food, on top of paying all the other taxes we do? That's why people have $21,000 or $250,000. Now, if that person that we're talking here qualifies for $600 a month pension, and they get the old age security, and let's say both husband and wife do, they're now looking at $2,200 a month. If they want to have a $3,200 a month income retirement, they should have another $240,000, which just coincidentally happens to be the number pretty close to what we pay the bank and what we pay Revenue Canada. If we didn't have to pay them, we actually could do something with our retirement. Okay, let's quit talking about some doom and gloom. Let's look at some good news here. Banks. Banks can be our best friends. You don't believe me? How banks become our friends? Can anybody doubt the fact that banks make a lot of money? Mm-hmm. They're money machines. They can make money every which way going. But one of the biggest ways they make money is on the spread. Now, if we listen to what a bank's telling us, and we can train ourselves to be a bank, we can do what they do. Now, here's a situation where, on the left here, we have Miss Finance-Wise, who's putting her money in the bank, and the banker says, here, I will give you 1.5%. On the other hand, we have a young person who's buying a car, who wants to get a $5,000 loan, and the bank says, well, you don't have a great credit rating. You've only been at your job for 3 or 4 months. So we'll give it to you at 8%. Now, you can see Ms. Finance-Wise here, she's kind of looking around the corner saying, but you just gave him my money. You gave me 1.5. That spread of 6.5 stays with the bank. And most of us that put money in the bank, or that used to put money in the bank, think it's a good deal because banks are safe. And we need them because they're liquid. And we need a place to transact our business. And I looked at banks the same way. I looked at a bank the same for a mortgage. I had lines of credit, so I was investing. I had the mortgage. We had our emergency fund in the bank. We had a car loan. We had all this stuff. And every one of those is a profit center for the bank. Now, we're in the book. We're just going to flip to go this a little bit. But this is a situation in the book. And I'm not going to go through this much because you can read it. It's just outlining, she has her house and a mortgage, she has a term deposit, she has a car loan, she has a bit of a bank account. She lives off her money. But in the top, we're looking at a bank that says, you know what, we have almost everything she does with the bank is a profit center. Her mortgage is a profit center. Her car loan's a profit center. Her term deposit is a profit center because they're loaning it back out for the spread. Her savings account is a wonderful profit center. They only give her 0.5% and they loan it out as well. She has a checking account, which is a wonderful profit center. They don't pay her any interest on the money in the bank and they charge her to keep it there. So the bank is taking all kinds of stuff. There's other ways of banking, that the all-in-one bank account, which rolls everything pretty well together. And it was a very interesting to me. Now, in this case, if she ran out her traditional mortgage over 25 years, it takes her 25 years to pay it off. If you flip it into what's called an all-in-one mortgage, and Joanna can talk about those a little later when she meets with you, but by changing nothing except the type of mortgage or the type of accounts you have, you can knock off, maybe 8-10 years off your mortgage with the same cash flow. Well, when I first heard that, I didn't believe it. When I first heard it, I said, I don't understand how this works, because I've been dealing with banks for a long time. I know they rip us off. I just didn't know how badly. And I went to a seminar, and a gentleman at the seminar was from a bank. And he said, do you know how a mortgage works? And we said, yes, I've had mortgages a long time. We pay them, eventually, hopefully we pay them off. He said, do you know how the mortgage is structured? I said, oh yeah, it's, 25 amortization, 5-year term. He said, no, that's the terms. You know how it's structured. Okay, but now I was going to think, okay, there's another answer here, and I haven't got a clue. He said, are you familiar with the term compounding semi-annually? And I said, I'm familiar with the term. It's never been explained. He said, do you know that when you got your mortgage, you signed a piece, in that 45 or 50 pages that you're flipping through to quickly get out of the bank, in there, you signed a statement saying that this was explained to you and you understand it. I said, well, that's news to me. He said, what it really means is that when it compounds semi-annually, is the bank only changes the principal every 6 months. So when we make a blended payment to the bank, they don't reduce the principal. If you look at the amortization schedule, it'll do that. But in fact, they don't. They charge you interest on the full amount for 6 months. So if you have a combination of 1,000 principal and, let's say, 2,000 in interest, they will take the 2,000 interest, they'll take the 1,000 principal, but they don't apply it for 6 months. So at the end of 6 months, you are actually paying interest on $6,000 that you don't owe them. Then they will make the adjustment. I said, okay, now that explains why I've never been able to figure out, looking at a bank statement, why it never jives. I said, I could never figure that out. I said, so you mean most of my life, the bank has not only written me off in overt ways, but also covert ways? And he said, yes. He said, if you can change that one little thing by having it applied directly, you will save a fortune in your principal. Now, what was interesting to me, and something else he said that really got me thinking, is he said, with an all-in-one mortgage, he said, you are only required to pay interest only. And I thought, well, that's dumb. You want to get your mortgage paid off. And he still gave some examples. It still didn't make any sense to me, but I thought, why would I only want to pay my interest only? I want to get the mortgage paid off. After all, at some point, I would like to retire and be mortgage-free. And I went home and started thinking about it. And I remembered a seminar that I'd been to a few months earlier. It wasn't Trump. It was somebody else who was just as bad. And he was arrogant. He was horrible. But he said something that made me stick. He said, first, after he told us how wealthy he was, what a brilliant investor he was, and why we should sign up for his course, because he's the most brilliant man on the planet, he said, yeah, you know him too? No. He said, I have a mortgage.
Somebody in Hawaii and got mad at him.
Yeah. He said, every wealthy person I know has a mortgage. And the reason is a mortgage is the cheapest money you'll ever borrow. And if you know how to invest, you can get the spread yourself. And I went home and I thought, when I saw how this worked, I thought, you know what? That makes a lot of sense. I know how to make more money than, let's say, the bank. So if the bank right now is charging 3% interest, it doesn't take a whole lot to realize that I can get a spread on that that I can keep. So if I actually do exactly what a bank does, where a bank will take investors' money, give them a portion of it, loan it out to somebody in a mortgage, and most of the bank's assets are in mortgages, that's where the bulk of their assets are, they have their mortgage out at 3.5%, they're paying 1.5%, they keep that spread. If I can do the same thing and think like a bank and go, I want to use other people's money. We've heard that term, OPM, other people's money. You know where we get it? Bank. Yeah. Most of these seminars will teach you can get it some other place, and they will teach you how to do that, but it's going to cost you. The bank has investors' money, which they are depositors. They're loaning to us as a mortgage. Do you really think a bank wants their money back? No, they don't. Absolutely not. Why would the bank want your money back? If they get it back, they have to get it out to somebody else. They're spending money on advertising, because if they don't get it out to somebody else, they're still responsible to pay the saver. So they're more than happy if we do not give the principal back. They're getting their spread every month. So I all of a sudden I clued in and thought, wait a minute. If I can get money at 3.2 and I can turn it around and I can get 6 or 7%, I'm doing the same thing a bank is. I'm using the original depositor's money, the bank is keeping getting a spread, and I'm getting a spread. Why would I want to pay the bank their money back? And when that sort of came together, I realized that's the whole idea of creating a pension. If I don't have to pay the money back to the bank, I get to use it. And if I can take the money and I can earn a 5 or 6% spread on it, my cash flow starts immediately, not 30 years down the road or 40 years down the road when my nest egg is finally together. Now, on the top here is a traditional mortgage. She has a 25-year mortgage, $1,300 a month. She pays every month. It's paid off in 25 years. But she has zero cash flow. Remember, she's paying that with after-tax dollars. So she has zero cash flow for 25 years. On the other hand, by implementing this strategy of saying, I'm going to borrow the money for my mortgage, but I'm not going to pay it back, I'm going to use the money that I would have paid back. So instead of having a traditional mortgage where I have a blended payment of interest and principal, I now have a mortgage where I'm only responsible to pay interest. So the principal I was paying back, I'm saving, and I'm investing. So we'll go back to the earlier slides. By changing the type of mortgage, you can free up to $10,000 to $15,000 a year on principal payments. Now, if I say I'm going to have $10,000 freed up, or $15,000, in my case it was $15,000, if I have $15,000 that I was paying out to the bank in interest on a mortgage, and interest on a car loan, and interest on an investment loan, and I wrapped them together and said, okay, the amount has gone up a bit, but the payment's gone down dramatically now, I'm going to save that principal and I'm going to invest it. Well, in the first year, I had $15,000. I did not pay it to the bank, I had it. So what I did now is when I invest that $15,000, where it cash flows. I'm not interested in mutual funds, I'm not interested in something that is going to save for the future, invest for the long term. I want to invest that's going to pay me cash at least every month and at worst every quarter. Now, if you have to start with, your payment, in this case, she went from $1,300 down to $730, and that's outlined in the book. And in the first year, she had, I think it was $10,000 to invest. Her cash flow starts in year one. In year one, she's now got, you know, let's say she had $10,000 at 8%. She's still paying the interest. If the interest is 3 and she's making 8, she's got the spread, but that 8% is paying her now about $70 a month. And if she does that every year, in about the 8th or 9th year, she doesn't have a mortgage payment. She has a mortgage, but the payment is generated by the investments of money that she did not pay the bank back.
How do you answer people who argue that you want to pay down the mortgage debt, and not paying down the mortgage debt is being irresponsible?
Well, if they honestly believe that, pay it down. But often, once you find out how it generates cash, they will change your way of thinking. I'll give an example of that a little later. But in this case, by the 8th year, the investment income is actually making her mortgage payment for her. Then, each year after that, it actually starts creating a positive cash flow. In the same 25-year period, instead of just paying her mortgage off, she has the same mortgage, but she also has about a $1,300 or $1,400 a month payment coming to her. So the investments are paying the mortgage and giving her an additional $1,300, $1,400 a month. When they grasp that idea that, okay, I still have a mortgage, but what I've done is I've paid it, you know, down, borrow back, whatever invested, all of a sudden the mortgage doesn't bother them because they've got the offsetting investments. But more importantly, they have an income. Now, I've often heard, and I had one case where it was an older couple who said, we don't want to pay the mortgage off because when we die, we want to pay the mortgage off, when we die, it's better for the kids to have a clear title. And they were in their 50s and they said, and we do not want a mortgage. When we retire, we want it gone. We've worked really, really hard to have our mortgage gone. And I said, great, so you've got no mortgage. And he said, no. I said, are you earning anything off your house? And they said, what do you mean? I said, so you don't have a mortgage, but you still have taxes, you still have utilities, you still have your heat, you still have your gas, you know, you've still got payments every month. Is your house paying for those, or are you paying for them? And they said, well, we're paying for them. But we want to have the house clear title so that when we die, the kids get a clear title house. I said, okay, let's switch this around a bit. I said, you've got a house that's worth about $500,000. This is when I talked, it's now worth about seven, but it was worth about $500,000, it's paid for. Now, if you both die the next few years, you have three kids, they're going to inherit approximately, what, $165,000 each? And they said, yes. I said, but if you use the equity in the house and you invest it, it will create an income for you. And they said, but then we've got a mortgage. I said, yes, but more importantly, you have investments and an income so that the income will pay for your mortgage. I said, now, let's say you do this over a number of years and you've still got your $500,000 house. You now have a $250,000 mortgage on it, but you also have $250,000 of investments. I said, your equity in home is exactly the same. You've still got $500,000. The difference is you're now earning money on the $250,000 that will give you a monthly income. Now, I said, in both situations, the kids are going to end up with exactly the same. The difference is now you will earn an extra amount of money. You will earn an extra couple thousand a month. Which is more important to you, having your kids earn exactly the same and not have an income, or earn exactly the same and you get $2,000 a month now? What do you think they chose? He read my book 8 times. He said, it's the only financial book he's ever read in his life. He said, I understand it, and I'm going to do it. And they're happy. The investment advisor I sent them to is also very happy. Now, I want to talk a little bit about my kids here. My daughter is 29. Her husband is 28. This is the young lady who edited my book, or helped edit my book. Now, they live in Prince George. They both have good jobs. They both have pensions. Their home's worth about $300,000. They've got a mortgage of $237,000 at 2.84. Now, the reason they didn't go the all-in-one is they only had 10% down. You need 20% for the all-in-one. They got a car loan of $15,000. Now, they did have enough money to buy the car, and actually they bought a Ford Escape. I said, no, you're going to finance it. The reason you're going to finance it is I want you to have a budget where you're going to be paying $1,500 a month. I want that as part of your budget. So next July, when it comes up, they're going to flip it into the all-in-one. Their payment is going to drop from $1,500 a month down to about $659 or $660 a month. That will free up about $10,000 a year. Does that change their cash flow at all? Does it change their cash flow? Okay, yes, because they've invested. Does it change their cash flow from the standpoint, are they having to find an extra $10,000? No. This is exactly the same cash flow they have today. I'm not saying to this young couple who wants to start a family, you have to come up with an extra $10,000 a year over the next number of years to retire. That's the traditional financial planning. I'm saying you don't have to come up with any money. I'm going to find it for you. We're going to go into interest only, and this is what Johanna's learned. You take the money, and they're going to invest it. So without having putting any additional money out, for the next 10 years, if they can earn 8%, which they can, that's being conservative, their mortgage payment's now covered. So that's freed up an extra, you know, basically from right now, like $1,500 a month. Now, at that point, they will be, you know, 40 years old. They don't have any mortgage payment. And she said, I don't really want a mortgage, but I sure like the idea of having an extra $1,500 bucks a month. That would make a huge difference in our life. At that point, she did say, we don't need to go on and create a pension per se, because she's an assistant librarian for the city. She has a pension. My son-in-law works for Canfor. He has a pension. They said, what we want to do is save the money to invest. So at that point, once their mortgage is covered, they're going to switch over to the TFSA, and they're now going to put the $10,000 into the TFSA for the next 25 years. If they earn the same 8%, it'll grow to almost $800,000. If they draw out at 5%, that'll give them an income of almost $40,000, leaving 3% to offset inflation. The interest is almost $8,000, which means they'll have a pension of approximately $2,650 a month, tax-free, because it's coming out of their TFSA. On top of that, they will both have their maximum CPPs, both have their older security, and have two pensions. Am I ever jealous? If only I had known this when I was younger. Okay? And the fact that they create all this without any additional savings. They're not having to go into their, they're not having to skimp and save and come up with an extra $10,000. It's going to be created just by using this strategy. If they stayed on their existing course, they'll pay off their mortgage in 25 years. They'll be about age 53. Then they can divert about 18,000 TFSAs. For the next 12 years, it'll grow to about 369. They will then have an income of about $1,500 a month, leaving three offset. Which would you rather have? 2650 after tax or 1500? The main difference as well is during that whole time of 25 years, they've got an outlay of $1,500. By switching over to the strategy, in the first year, they start creating cash flow to pay their mortgage. So at the end of 10 years, it's paid for by somebody else. This is a saving strategy, not a leverage strategy. Now, if somebody has their house paid for and puts a mortgage on invest, that would be leverage. If you have a traditional mortgage where you have your blended rate of your principal and your interest, and you switch to interest only, and you save that difference that was principal, that is savings. Okay? If you are saving it now, you want to be very tax efficient as well. So one step, before I take the savings and say, here, Johanna, here's my $10,000, before I do that, I take the money, I pay down the line of credit or the mortgage, borrow it back, and then give it to her. Now, what that one step did by paying down and borrowing back, when I borrowed that money back, the purpose is for investments. Interest is deductible when it's used for investment purposes. So in their case here, they would still have $237,000 mortgage. That hasn't changed, or $247,000. They've paid, they'd have the, saved the $10,000. They paid down, down, so they got $237,000, borrow back the $10,000, stays at $247,000. The difference is that the $247,000 is now split. $237,000 is a mortgage, $10,000 is investment loan. So if they do that every year, they're converting their mortgage into an investment loan. So again, we talked earlier about Revenue Canada taking so much of our money. This is a way of keeping it back. Saying, if I can write off the interest, then Revenue Canada actually gives me money back, which means that I can accelerate the whole program again. Okay, it's not going to be easy. Now, the reason it's not, it sounds wonderful, and it does work. I've been doing it for a number of years now. I have a number of people that do it. The hard part is keeping strategy foremost. Because when you switch from the regular mortgage to interest only, you immediately have cash flow. What do you do with cash flow? Spend it. Yeah. No. You don't want to spend it, because with the strategy, if you spend it, you will not be doing anything but having a really happy, great life now, but you're still going to have a mortgage at the end. You have to be disciplined to say, okay, we live on what we have now. We're going to use that to invest. And once you start doing it, investing maybe in 5,000 amounts, it doesn't take long, 3 or 4 months, to get together $5,000. And all of a sudden, the next month, you get a check from interest. It goes like, wow, this works. Now let's save the next 5,000. The real key to this, I found, is to get the wife on board. If the husband is on board, or not on board, and the wife is, it will work. If it's the other way around, it doesn't. Men like their toys. They like new trucks, new cars, boats, skidoos. But if you together, you can say, this is our commitment. We are going to do this. We're going to stick with it. And it, the nice thing is, it starts right away. Like within 4 or 5 months of starting it, you can actually see cash flow coming. And then you say, yes, this works. And now it becomes, you know, something that just goes. That's why I say it's not going to be easy, but it's definitely worth it. My mortgage, when I started this program, was $1,650 a month. I had a car loan, an investment loan. I was paying $2,650 a month. When I switched over to the all-in-one, my payment dropped to about $1,650. So I had $1,000 a month and stuck with it every month. At the end of the year, we actually had $15,000, not $12,000. I still aren't quite sure where that other $3,000 came from, but I was happy for it. And we stuck that, and it just every year has grown from that. Today, my net mortgage is under $400 a month. My mortgage is exactly the same. So in about an 8-year period, we went from 2650 down to 400. So it definitely works. Ralph Waldo Emerson stated that an ounce of action is worth a ton of theory. Now, you can sit here tonight and listen, you can read all kinds of books. If you don't actually do something, you may be more intelligent, but it's not going to get your goals. And if you would love to turn your mortgage into a pension, and if you've already got a pension, great. Would you like an extra pension? I don't think anyone's turned it on. If you're getting CPP and it's max, great. Would you like an extra $1,000 or $2,000 a month? I started the program in my 50s. I'm 61 now. Next year, or about in a year and a half, I will not have a mortgage payment. My investments will cover it. Now, if I had not started this strategy 8 years ago, I would still be paying out $1,650 a month plus. So within approximately 10 years, and the only reason to take that long is the first couple investments I made were not so good. They sounded good, but they don't cash flow the way I still was not thinking completely in cash flow. Now I do. I only invest for cash flow, and that makes all the difference. But that is it. Thank you very much for your attention, and good luck.
Thank you, Gord. That was wonderful.
Thank you.
All right. So wasn't that eye-opening? It was interesting. I want to thank Sylvia McQuillan. She's the one that introduced me to Gord Johnson and told me she brought his book last year, and I was just going, wow, this is so incredible. So I love it when I bring in guest speakers and I learn as much as you guys do, because it just changed my world. So the missing piece that Gord didn't talk about, though, is like we want you to take action and not just keep it theoretical. And it doesn't work with all investments, right? Has anybody ever done the Smith maneuver or anything like that with mutual funds? And you end up losing your money on the mutual funds and now you're in debt. It's like, oh, that really backfired. So we don't want you to just do this with any old investment. It needs to be very specific. And last time Gord did talk about some of the investments, but we brought in some specialists tonight that will talk. You'll get to hear about some investments directly from the companies that run them. So before I bring them up, just briefly here, I want to explain what the exempt market is. And sometimes it's easier to explain what it isn't. So the exempt market is all of the private investments that aren't sold on the stock market. So we have our private and then public. And the benefits to the private market is that it provides that steady monthly income that is quite a bit higher than, say, dividends that you get on stocks. Moderate growth, you can have tax-advantaged income on some of these investments. And then they also are backed by real estate, so it's not going up and down. It's backed by property. Low volatility and really strong track record. So all of our investments, you'll hear about two of them tonight. We do have a whole bunch of other ones as well, but they all follow this model. And just to show you the stock market, this is the TSX over the last, 30 years. And, you know, today, it's lower than it was 8 years ago, right? So you can see how if you're buying stocks, this is what he was talking about for the long haul, it just doesn't work, you know? And it will be very stressful if you're doing this strategy with this type of investment. Can you guys see that? It says, is it better to invest during a bull market or a bear market? Depends. Would you rather be gored or mauled? Yeah, I know, that was lame, sorry. Trying to lighten the mood here. So to compare, we have this, and then the private markets. This is the same 30 years with the private apartment index. So you can see it's very steady growth. It just kind of rises with inflation. That's the benefit of investing with private equity and, you know, real assets. So I also like to look at the professionals, and if you're building your own pension with this strategy, what are real pension funds doing? And they're actually, because of low interest rates, it says right here, they are looking at alternatives that behave like bonds, like real estate. So, you know, your CPP, you guys are all invested in that. I feel good knowing that they are moving into private equity as well. About 15 years ago, they didn't have any in their portfolio. Now it's almost half. So our next speaker is Graham Keeler from Excellent Capital. He is the Senior Vice President. So just a show of hands, who here has invested in mutual funds? Anybody? Okay, who's met the companies of those stocks? Yeah, you have?
No, I met the people that okay. brought.
Well, this is one of the real cool benefits. You're going to meet the guy that's running this company, and afterwards you can ask him all the questions you want. So please put your hands together for Graham Keeler.
Thank you very much. I normally talk with my hands, but they're full now. So my name is Graham Keeler. I'm the Vice President at Excellent Capital Management, which is a boutique private equity firm based out of Toronto. And I appreciate the enthusiasm. I don't run the company. I live in Kelowna. It's a Toronto company. I'm the Vice President of Business Development. You'll get to meet the gentleman that started the company and actually runs the show. So what we're going to do, you've seen one of these already. So that saves me from reading it line by line. And really all of this says is that you're not here to buy anything tonight. This is information only, and you're encouraged to read the documents, the offering memorandum, and talk to your agent prior to investing. Is this loud enough? Okay, good. So Excellent Capital, as I mentioned, is a Toronto boutique investment firm specializing in the exempt or private equity space. It was founded in 2002, so it's a 14-year-old company, and we'll get to meet the founder and president in a minute here. And it's the management and portfolio manager and founder of the company, Dan Pemberton, has really honed his experience over the years working with larger financial institutions, pricing, really giving him the ability to price through debt crises, recessions, all kinds of issues. He's got, it says 20 years on the screen, it's actually about 25 years experience now as a trader, a portfolio manager, investment fund manager, and a corporate financial professional. And the mission of the company is really just to provide various alternative products to help agents and their clients diversify their portfolios. So Excellent Capital, as mentioned, is a Toronto company. So our primary security commission, the primary oversight in our company is the Ontario Securities Commission, but we are registered in every province under all the securities commissions. And we're registered as portfolio managers, investment fund managers, and a bit more of a unique designation, unique in the fact there isn't that many of them around, commodity trading managers as well. So as I mentioned, our funds are managed by a portfolio manager who's, I'm just gonna give you just a brief history on the PM, President Dan Pemberton. He's about 49, maybe 50 years old now. When he graduated with his MBA a number of years ago from Brock University, one of the first jobs he took on was he moved from Toronto to Montreal, and he worked as a trader on the Montreal Commodity Exchange. And that was back in the day, it's not that many years ago, but it's still back in the day. You've likely seen this on TV or movies where in the old days in the New York Stock Exchange and all the other exchanges, they actually had floor traders running around the floor with little chia, right, yelling and screaming and trading millions of shares on a piece of little chit of paper. I'll buy a million. And that's how that was done. Really exciting for a young guy, a new MBA He actually left that after a few years when they went computerized because all the joy was out of it. But the reason that I say this is it really honed his experience trading large quantities of stocks and doing institutional trading. So that was his initial background. Dan went from there to an investment group called Dominion Securities, which is now RBC, or Royal Bank of Canada Dominion Securities, where he became the youngest vice president of their global money market worldwide. He was handling about a $3.5 billion fund. So again, a lot of institutional experience as a floor trader and a portfolio manager, et cetera. So that's just a bit of the background of our founder, and there he is. So I've kind of gone through this. So that's basically Dan Pimbleton. This is, oh, there we go. And since the 2000s, after he founded the company, and he actually started out working with institutions when he founded Accelent Capital, but really what his goal was not to go the institutional route anymore in that respect, but create his own from the ground up, his own business models, his own private equity funds that he could manage himself, not for somebody else, and have their rules and guidelines. He wanted to use his integrity to build funds. So he started with, he had a flow-through fund, or still do, it's actually a flagship fund called Pavilion Resource Fund. We're also the Canadian arm of the Wine Invest, and that's wine as in wine, red and white, the Wine Investment Fund of Canada, and that's an arm of the original Wine Investment Fund from London, England, which is the first true return investment-grade wine fund in the world, and they've been around for years. So we periodically come out in Canada with the wine fund. It's not out right now in the market. We did a real estate fund. We took advantage in 2008 of that crisis, recession, and real estate downturn worldwide, and as a number of groups did, went into the States, into Phoenix in particular, the Arizona, and raised capital from Canadians, went down, bought distressed real estate, fixed them up a little bit, the houses, rented them out. People got cash flow every month. And in fact, right now, we're winding that fund up. It's been about 7 years or so now. Those houses are all getting sold. So investors got a return, a yield month after month on the product, and now they're going to get their capital gain or capital growth. So that was another fund that we had in the market. And we just released a couple months ago a fund called Capture, Hedged Oil and Gas Fund. It's just getting onto the market now, and that's not what we're talking about tonight, but Capture is a fund that Mr. Pimbleton, with his background in commodities and trading, decided to, the timing was right to come up with an actual hedged fund to take advantage of this oil crisis. And it looks like it's going to be a very, very interesting fund because he has the capabilities and the designations to actually, if you understand trading and hedging, a lot of people don't. It's just where you you take the downside risk out of a product using different hedging techniques and still take advantage of the majority of the upside. So the volatility in this oil market plays right into his hands on that. So that's a product we'll be coming out with in the general market fairly soon. Tonight we're going to talk about REV Royalty. The full name is REV Royalty Income and Growth Trust. We call it REV for short. And what REV is basically it's almost a non-correlating, but we like to be conservative and call it a low correlating to the public markets. That's what I mean by low correlating. The product doesn't go up and down with the markets. It's totally separate. So it's low correlating, which is a very good thing. It's a diversified portfolio of a number of different asset classes, kind of a fund of funds, if you will. So it's one investment that has a number of different totally separate asset classes in the fund that don't relate to each other, in fact. Okay? So that's what REV basically is, and we'll talk about the asset classes in a minute. Why a fund like this with various assets in them? Well, as we've heard tonight, we're in a low interest rate arena right now, and that looks like it's going to continue for some time. Traditional GICs, the yields are just too low right now for anybody to get ahead that way. Dividend paying stocks really leave investor capital at risk. So REV Royalty, in essence, provides lending, where it's basically a lending tool through outside preferred originators, meaning other businesses that we're lending to, other asset classes, and ourselves as the originator on one of the assets itself. And again, we'll talk about that in a minute. So the fund actually yields monthly distributions. Okay, well, it's annual return paid monthly into your registered account, your TFSA, your RSP, your LIRA, or whatever it is, or into your bank account. So it's a it's an annual income paid monthly, and a diversified portfolio, of course, really does create more stable distributions, meaning that if it is separate asset classes that we're investing in, if one of those asset classes, it doesn't matter what it is, it could be real estate, it could be something else, if one of them goes, and every asset class goes through ups and downs, if one of them goes through a bit of a low time, well, the other asset classes aren't correlating to it, so they're still doing well. What that does is really stabilizes what they call the net asset value or NAV of the portfolio. And that's the whole purpose of this fund. There are a couple of funds in the private equity world that have multiple asset classes, but very, very few. Most funds in our world have traditionally been one asset class. And that's what you're buying into. So just understand the difference. So, and as I mentioned, these strategies are not directly related in any way to the ups and downs of the public markets. So there's a lot of stuff on this slide, but basically what this is saying is, why do it in private equity? Why don't the banks do this if it's so great? Well, as we heard in the prior presentation, the banks really are not into what we call niche market type of products or investing. That's not how they're making money. We've learned how they make it from fees and charges at the bank, and the spread, which is huge. But really, what they do is they stick to traditional, highly collateralized lending, mortgages, that type of business. They don't take the risks, okay? So they miss out on the little higher-paying type of activities. That's where companies like us can come in and do. And they're also not interested in raising $10 or $20 or $50 million. To them, that's small. To us, that's big. Okay. So that's really why we're in the market doing this. Now, how REV works is similar to any other investment. We have to identify. It's one thing to raise capital, you know, do slick presentations and get people to invest money with us or in a specific product. That's one aspect to it, raising capital. But we have to be able to do something with that capital. Raising cash doesn't do us any good. We're not going to put it into a GIC. So we need to identify deals. Dan Pembleton is the key player in the organization, but there are other people that we bring in on various investments. And Rev Royalty, in fact, Dan surrounded himself with a board of advisors, or an investment committee, as they're called. You won't recognize their names, likely, in your folders. I did outline who they are and some background on them. I won't go through it here. You'll see their faces on the screen only, basically. But he surrounded himself with this team for a number of reasons, but one of the main ones was to bring deals to us. So we have deal flow. And they're experts in their various fields in Canada. We also need a team, our internal team and the investment committee or board of advisors, to help with due diligence on products or investments that we're looking to put your money into. So due diligence is a huge part of this, and that can take months on any given investment behind the scenes. If everything works out, we make the investment. We buy that into that lending product or whatever the asset class is, and we target returns back to investors. Now, the target minimum return on Rev Royalty is 8%. So it's an 8% yield product. That is income. Okay, it's not tax efficient in any way. It's income. So it's pure yield. We've also targeted mainly one asset class that I'm going to talk briefly about that will have potential for capital growth down the road as well. Maybe another 2% or 3% a year in our estimation of capital growth. So there could be participation in capital gain or capital growth on top of it. But mainly it is an 8% target minimum yield product. Okay, and again, 8% annually, paid monthly. So as I mentioned, deal flow is one critical area of this. And the investment committee that we've surrounded ourselves with are really key players in their fields in Canada. And if you do any research on them, when you look at their names or Google them, whatever, you'll kind of track some of their history. These are some of the highest ranking people in the country in natural resource investments, in merchant banking, business royalties, mining and oil and gas royalty, real estate, mergers and acquisitions. This is the type of crew that we've amassed. A lot of experience in factoring, leasing, structured finance, and those are the type of deals we're looking for. So, of course, the chairman of the committee is Dan himself. Mr. Paul Krath, JD, is his designation. JD actually stands for Juris Doctor. And Juris, he's a lawyer. He's a very, very well-known international M&A, mergers and acquisition lawyer. He was with a white case in New York. He's a Toronto guy. JD is a designation some lawyers are now using. It came out of New York. They're now Juris Doctors. They're still lawyers. And again, I'm not going to go through the names here. Tom Meredith, some people might recognize the Meredith name. Some people may recognize the Thompson name in Canada in the mining sector. So how REV stands apart, as I mentioned, we have various asset classes in the portfolio. We've identified, the team has identified five main separate asset classes. And again, the reason for separate asset classes is the non-correlation, but it's also for diversification. We all understand diversification is a really good thing, but quite frankly, I don't think everybody always understands what diversification really is. And you know, I've been doing this type of thing. I've been in the investment world for a lot of years. I've talked to a lot of people, a lot of clients. I've sat at a lot of tables, and I've asked one question periodically: do you feel you're diversified right now in your portfolio? And inevitably, people say, yes, I think I am. Well, what have you got? What does your portfolio consist of? Well, I'm diversified. I've got 14 different mutual funds. That's not diversification. It's at least they were investing. But that really isn't diversification. Diversification in a portfolio is having various asset classes that aren't all going to take hits at the same time. And as you're probably well aware, one asset class can go up and down dramatically. We saw it in real estate, especially in the U.S. in 08. It can happen. It can happen in any asset class. So true diversification, I actually consider more asset allocation. Okay? So that's what REV is. There's five categories of assets been identified for it. We do have a very experienced investment committee and portfolio manager, which brings us access to some very, very interesting niche markets in North America. And multiple categories allows the portfolio manager and the committee to allocate capital strategically between those asset classes. We will not likely be in all five of them at the same time. Just be aware of that. I'll talk about the asset classes, but it doesn't mean we're in them all today or maybe ever we'll be in all of them. But it's the identified areas that we're looking at. And what they are is, in general terms, is medical factoring and general factoring, cloud services financing and traditional leasing, mining, resource and business royalties, consumer credit, structured finance, that can be a number of different areas, and real estate as well. What I'm going to talk about today are only three of the asset classes. I think we understand real estate and the various things we could get into. And I will tell you right now, we're not looking at real estate today. There is none in the fund, and there won't be any in there in the near future. We will look at it if we find and identify a very unique opportunity in Canada, probably, at some point. We are, though, and this fund has been on the market for, well, really for about 3 months, maybe four, but through December, there's not much activity in Canada in the investment world, so really about 3 months. We've already invested in leasing, factoring, okay, which are debt plays, and we're now getting ready to move into medical factoring and cloud services financing. We're just waiting for the white deals to come along. The fund is called, though, REV Royalty, and the original asset class that Dan, the original idea from a few years ago when he started thinking about this fund was the royalty business. Can anybody, and I don't want to put you on the spot, but I like a little participation. Can somebody tell me what a royalty is on something? When you get a royalty, you get a cut. Yeah, well, you get a cut, and it's what we call a top line cut. Has anybody ever watched the show Dragon's Den? Yeah, I haven't missed an episode, whatever, 13 years the show's been, whatever. I've seen every episode. So you know our friend Kevin O'Leary, right? What are they? Oh, Mr. Wonderful, right? They call him Mr. Wonderful. 9 times out of 10 on the Dragon's Den, when it gets to Kevin O'Leary talking to that entrepreneur that came into the room with their new backpack or widget or their idea, what does he typically go for? Royalties, that's right. I didn't understand that so much a number of years ago. Why was he always negotiating for a royalty, even to the point where he didn't care about getting any equity of their company? He just wanted that royalty. The reason is because royalties are top line. They really have nothing to do with the day-to-day operation of the business expenses, really the ultimate success, as long as the business stays open. Right? It's not net income from the business. A royalty, when it's negotiated with a company or a mining resource, is a piece of their sale. Every time that they sell something, you get a piece first before they get their piece and pay their expenses. So that's what I mean by top line. Just to use a quick example, let's say it's in the mining industry. It could be anything, but if it's in the mining business, let's say it's a gold company and they're digging gold out of the ground and sending it off to be refined or do whatever. When it goes to the smelter, the refiner, depending on the metal in the case, when at the smelter themselves or that refinery, actually when they do their job and they pay the royalty owners first and then they pay the business, the gold mine. Okay, their royalties are very preferred in the investment world. This is one of, if not the first, investment opportunities in the exempt market or private space, this OM-based, they call it, market, to have royalties in it. And again, they're internally, they're complicated to run. Our investment committee two of the guys in our investment committee are the top guys ever in Canada in the mining resource royalty field. So we have the expertise to do this. We will be going out sometime this year negotiating some royalties and getting them into the fund. Okay, so that's what royalties are. That's basically what happens with that. There's all kinds of reasons right now that, especially in the mining sector and the oil and gas sector, that companies are more than willing to negotiate a decent royalty to raise capital because their share prices are down so bad they don't want to raise it through raising more equity. So they will negotiate royalties. Another asset class that I mentioned was medical factoring. And this is going to be in the portfolio quite shortly, actually. I just spoke to Dan this morning about it. We're specifically targeting U.S. medical receivables as a lending area. Okay, very, very profitable. This is not a new thing. It's been going on for many, many years. And what it effectively is factoring. And I won't ask if anybody knows what factoring is. A lot of you will. But what factoring means is when an individual, a small business, a large corporation sells some receivables at a discount to another company called a factor, so they get some cash right away and they can even out their cash flow. All businesses, including the biggest ones in the world, go through, well, maybe not Apple, but most of them go through cash flow issues. They're up and down all the time. So to even it out, they'll sell some receivables that haven't been paid yet and pay a fee to get some of the cash right now. That's factoring. It's been around for forever. Okay? And again, I to kind of bring it home, because I know some of this can seem a little complicated, many years ago, I lived in Edmonton for a lot of years, and I was a realtor back in the day. I signed up with REMAX and sold houses. Well, when my buddy that owned the REMAX convinced me to come and do that and be a realtor, I didn't realize that you didn't really make any money for a while. But you still had to pay REMAX's monthly desk fee, they called it. They wanted their money, right? So I started in the business, and they said, yeah, well, your first month, that'll be $1,500. Well, I haven't even listed a house. Well, get out there. So I got out there. And, you know, you eventually get some clients, and you get a house or two listed, and then eventually something sells. Well, eventually. And then when I did sell up my first property, I kind of thought, well, that's great. I'll get paid. Well, actually, you don't get paid as a realtor until the closing date on the property. So that could be two more months down the road. So they said, well, I said, well, this is a cash flow problem for me. And they said, well, why don't you do what most of the realtors do and factor your commission? And I'd never heard of it. So even individuals do that. So there was factoring companies that realtors were going to factor that future commission at a discount. In other words, a penalty, a interest, so I could get the cash right away and pay Remax, right? That's factoring. We're just doing it on a bigger level, and we're doing it with U.S. medical receivables. And these are receivables that U.S. doctors, clinics, hospitals are waiting for from the insurance companies, like Blue Cross. And that's the type of people groups we're dealing with, is these will be Blue Cross receivables, et cetera. We're not looking at workers' comp type receivables or car accident type receivables, those type of things. This before Obamacare, doctors, hospitals, and clinics could have waited 60 to 90 days to get paid by the insurance company for the medical receivable. When the Obamacare legislation or Managed Care Act came in, it's a wonderful thing, I believe. It gave millions of more people access to insurance, but it added another federal layer of bureaucracy on top of the insurance now. So it added even more time before the doctor, the clinic, or the hospital got paid. So there's even more factoring going on today. And you understand that the U.S., the medical industry, especially in the U.S., is highly, highly profitable. They're more than willing to pay some pretty staggering fees or interest to get the money today. And they rotate it every 90 days or 120 days. It's not out for a year at a time. We have identified, one of our investment committee identified a preferred originator in the U.S., one of the larger factoring groups that does this with the U.S. medical factoring, and we will be bringing some of that into the portfolio. Okay, so that's factoring. The last one I'm going to talk about is cloud. I mentioned cloud services financing. Cloud services is sort of a newer term, computer term, tech term, if you will, and over the past few years. And again, a lot of you will know what it is. Some may not so much. All as it means, the cloud means, when you hear this terminology, is really, instead of storing all your data on your computer at home, your laptop or computer on its hard drive, and having all of your software on a disk and putting it into your hard drive, which takes up space, and managing that and doing all that. Now, again, individuals, small companies, large corporations are starting to put some of their stuff into the cloud to a cloud service provider to handle all that. It's really not in a cloud somewhere. It's a little bit of a misnomer and confusing to people. When you send something to a cloud service provider, it's in another warehouse. It could be down the street or across the planet somewhere. But it's just a bunch of computers called servers sitting in a big warehouse. Could be hundreds of them, thousands of them. You're just storing data and maybe getting software applications through a cloud service provider instead of having them yourself. And you pay a little fee every month for that, or a large fee if you're a large corporation. There was an article in Forbes somewhat recently, Forbes magazine, that said that, and I'll have the numbers a little bit wrong here, but from 2013 to 2017, the years 2013 to 17, cloud services contracts are expected to go from about $250 million a year to well over half a billion. This is, or $500 billion, sorry. It's a massively growing industry, and we're tapping into that. Okay, so we've already identified in Canada cloud service providers and a group that lends to them, specifically to a certain group. And we're tapping into that as well. So this could be and will be smaller companies using cloud service, but it could be the Royal Bank of Canada, for example, just as an example. That's the type of bigger corporation. Even companies like the Royal Bank and large corps are now starting to push some of their data, their software, their management out to third-party cloud service providers. What it's done, the change really is that instead of the Royal Bank in this example needing to buy more servers or computers, right, which costs capital, to store more of their data, more and more and more software all the time, and then hire more IT staff to run all that equipment, they're going, no, I'll just pay a monthly fee on a 5-year contract and let a cloud service provider do this for us. And that is what's happening. Okay, so we're tapping into that as well. So Rev Royalty, it's an open-ended fund. It just means there's no end date on this. This fund will likely go for many, 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 many years. So it's not a typical kind of, it's a 5-year fund and then you're paid your capital back. This can go on for forever, technically. So that's what open-ended means. Because it's an open-ended fund, we put liquidity into it, meaning there is a redemption options. You can get out. You don't have to stay on the forever ever plan. There's quarterly redemption options built into the fund, so you can redeem. In other words, you can say, I'm done, I've been in it for X years, I want out, and you can get out, really at any time. It is an 8% target minimum per annum, distributed monthly, and I say targeted minimum, and I've said that consistently here because this is not a guarantee. You need to understand that nothing is guaranteed. Well, really, nothing's guaranteed with any investment other than guaranteed investment certificates, GICs, guaranteed by the government. But that's our target minimum return every month is 8% plus potential capital gain down the road. And we are, it is registered for all, or eligible for all registered accounts as well. So you can buy it in non-registered in cash, or you can put it into your registered accounts as well. There's a couple of numbers on here that I do want to address. Portfolio management fee at the top there, you add the two together, it's 2%. Okay, 1.75 and 0.25. There is a 2% management fee on the fund. That's in the industry terms, that's called an MER, okay, management expense ratio. So there is, and all of our funds have some type of a fee on them like that. That's the and that's not something you pay. That's just 2% a year is taken out of our of the fund for management. It's a reasonable MER or management fee, reasonably low. And I can tell you that on smaller funds like ours, as a boutique firm in Canada, that is not how we make or hope to create our wealth. Is not from this management fee. It's really in place to keep the lights on, quite frankly, and all of our funds do that. It pays for our office in Toronto, and it actually, that's how I make most of my money, or the majority of my money, is I get paid. I'm not a salaried person. I get paid a piece of that MER as the VP of Business Development. So it kind of, and it pays our staff, et cetera. So, but that is in there. There is no administration fees or any other fees. You simply invest, and that's the way it goes. The real way that Dan and the team on all of our funds hope to create wealth for themselves is by putting in a performance fee on the funds. And all of our funds are built on performance. What that means is that when we say we're targeting a certain return, in Rev's case, 8%, we actually hope to do a little better than that, but we want to be conservative. In other words, don't overpromise. So we're targeting 8%. If, in fact, the fund generates higher than 8% yield in a year, at the end of the year, we calculate and we made 10% yield. We split. First of all, you get your 8%. Anything over the 8%, that bonus is split 80%, 20%, 80% to you, and the performance fee of 20% to Dan and the team. So who feels that on a fund or an investment that basically running it on a performance basis is a good thing? Yes. I mean, obviously, if for us to make money, you have to make money, and that's Dan has always built our funds that way. It's risky for us as well. There's a lot of cost involved. But we feel it's fair, and it's fair to investors. So we really are, what that means is all of us, and Dan in particular and his team down east, every morning when they get up, they really want to work hard to make sure that the fund outperforms. Okay, so that's how we make our money. And it's actually really critical when you're looking at any investment to understand how people make their money. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the question was, if you didn't hear it, on the 8% target return, is the 2% management fee already taken off of that, or does that come off? No, it's already gone. We're saying it's target minimum to you of 8%. And that brings up the question, well, how much are we getting return on these investments that we can pay you, you know, your 8 and take a 2% fee to run it? We're not looking at any investments or I won't say any, because we could look at something if it's a little less, but in general, we're not looking at anything that doesn't have what's called an IRR, or internal rate of return, to the fund of 12%. So anything we look at has to have the a minimum 12% return. And that gives us room to pay the 8 and have our fees and everything and still have a little cushion. I will tell you right now that things like U.S. medical factoring, when in that arena, and it's similar on a lot of other factoring we're looking at in leasing, but especially the U.S. medical, because it's so high profit, they will actually pay 2 to 3% per month to factor their receivables. Now, they only factor them for a few months, but if they did it for a year, that's 24 to 36% return. Okay? But again, they do it for a few months, but it's still 2 to 3%. And now, we don't get the whole 2 to 3% because we're going with a preferred originator that does this in the States. We'll get our cut. But I can tell you that in most cases, that'll be in the high teens. So there is room, and there's room for outperformance on this. And some of our other stuff is the same. Okay. So that's basically it. Just a little bit of difference between us, and I'm just going to, I got like two slides left here, that's it, most other funds in the private equity field are a fixed rate of return. We're actually, like I said, a base distribution, a target distribution with upside participation and potential. It's true income paid monthly from these investments. It's not paying back your capital, a little bit of your capital that you gave us. This is actually immediately true income coming in. It's most funds have a long-term lockup, or a lot of funds do. We do have a built-in redemption feature. Income delayed until financial close on subscriptions. That's a normal thing. Sounds complicated, but what all this means is in our case, if and when you with your advisor do an investment, as soon as it gets through their system and gets to us in our Toronto office and is approved, meaning everything's in order, and funded, meaning the money's there, the interest rate clock starts that day. You'll get paid the following month, but the interest rate clock, no matter when that deal comes in, as soon as it's done and funded, we start calculating interest. Okay, that 8%. All right, so most funds are one asset class. We're multiple asset classes. And most funds, you know, outside of the MIC world that we're going to hear about and our fund and maybe a couple others in the industry, most are actually operated by non-registrants, meaning non-registered with the securities commissions, et cetera. And as I've kind of beat to death, we are registered as PMs, IFMs, an EMD, commodity trading managers. There's a lot of eyes on us and our firm. Okay, and I think that gives some comfort. So who's Rev for? I don't mean to be facetious, but I think almost anybody, because it is multiple asset classes and it's an income product, but especially for those that maybe feel you're not diversified today, you're maybe too heavily into one asset class in your life, this will give you an opportunity to get into one fund with one fee and diversify some and get some asset allocation, quite frankly, without the added costs. So there we are. That's Rev. Great. Now I get to do this.
That's fine. Freedom. Hey. All right. Thanks, Graham. That was also wonderful. I really like Rev Royalty because of the $500 minimum. Yeah, it just, if any of you have cash accumulating in your Olympia Trust accounts and it's not the $5,000 or $10,000 minimum, you can actually put it into this and have that growing as well and compounding. So, and I've had some students that really want to start investing and, you know, they've made their first investment with $1,000 or $2,000. It's just fun to be able to finally get their money working. So, we have our next speaker. His name is Steve Fries from AP Capital, Mick, and he is a managing partner with AP Capital. Please put your hands together for Steve.
All right, so again, my name's Steve Froese, kind of like the weather in Edmonton. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about a MIC. Any of you here investors in MICs know what MICs are? Couple? Okay, so I'll start from the beginning. The disclaimer, this is just for educational purposes only. Okay, so the mortgage business in Canada, right back from, tell a little bit about how big the mortgage business is in Canada. There's about $1.5 trillion in mortgages in Canada, about 13% in commercial, and 87% in residential. So as you can see, the lion's share of the mortgage business in Canada is residential. It's not so much in commercial. And that's really the space that AP Capital plays in. There's about 620,000 home buyers per year. And this graph just shows the type of stuff that they buy. Again, the largest portion is 58.1% is single detached homes. And again, that is the majority of the marketplace that we play in. We don't touch a lot of the condominiums or semi-detached. We don't do a lot of, we have virtually no commercial mortgages in our portfolio whatsoever. Out of those 620,000 home buyers per year, 13% do it without a mortgage. So they actually pay cash and buy their houses. So good for them. The other 87% have to go to the bank for help. Sometimes that's the bank of dad. Most of the times it's one of the chartered institutions or credit unions or whatnot. Can you believe there's 9.62 million homeowners in this country? It's about 30 million people in Canada. 10 million are homeowners. 59% of them have a mortgage and 41% don't have a mortgage. So you can see Canadians like their homes. Another interesting statistic is even in the worst downturns, like in the 80s when interest rates went double digits, 20%, the actual foreclosures or the actual amount of people that actually lost their homes was very, very low. It was like 1.8%. So I know a lot of us heard all the stories about the jingle mail where people would mail their keys back to the banks. I know that's another concern right now in Alberta. They haven't had that for so many years because Alberta's been the poster child for success in the last decade. But right now, banks are actually getting these keys back in the mail because it's also the last province that has this law that you can't go after the borrowers personally for a conventional mortgage. So if you have a conventional mortgage in Alberta, decide you don't want to pay it, they actually can't even go after you for the difference if it's sold for less than what they are able to recoup. 11% of homeowners took equity out of their homes last year. Because a lot of times people ask us, well, where do you find your borrowers or what's your typical borrower? Because we're not a conventional bank, how do you find these people? And again, so out of roughly 10 million borrowers, a million people go every year can come and take equity of their homes. And the majority of it is for debt consolidation. Some do it for renovations, purchases, education, weddings. We had a couple of people that came to us. Their daughters were getting married. They needed money for a wedding. And, they had great jobs, but they just didn't know that it was coming so quickly. So they need a little bit of money to pay for a wedding. So in Canada's lending space, there's a bunch of different ways to borrow money. The rate is usually reflective of what type of lending that is. So we've got, on the very far end of the scale, we've got the Bank of Canada that sets their overnight rate. Currently it's at 0.5%. That's what banks charge each other when they borrow money overnight. And if there's anybody in this room that can borrow at that rate, I'd like to meet you, because that's basically free money. The next thing is conventional mortgage rates, anywhere from 2.5% to 3.5%. That's, again, your cheapest money. When Gord Johnson was talking about borrowing money, we are not the lender you want to come borrow money for on a mortgage, because we're going to charge you a lot more than the conventional mortgage lenders. Again, reasons why people would come to us instead of a traditional conventional mortgage lender is we're quick. Banks take a lot longer. They also have a lot more requirements. Our requirements are less stringent. We're more interested in equity than possibly the income, and I'll get into that a little bit later. And then you've got credit cards. They're anywhere from 11 to 22%. So if you have that wedding that sprung upon you, I would say maybe come see us before you go and pull that money off your credit card, because you're going to pay dearly. And then you've got payday loans way on the far end of the spectrum. That is very expensive money. Payday loans, you should never go and get those. again, sometimes people fall in hard times and they need them. Everybody needs access to capital at certain times, but if you can stay away from them, they're super expensive. This chart is super important as well because our capital is only as safe as the areas and the houses that we place the money on. It's you know, when we do mortgages, we want to make sure we get our money back. So we are always looking at the market and trying to assess, you know, where some problem areas are. Now, this little slide came from CMHC, Canada Housing and Mortgage Corporation. And what's interesting, when you look at some of the cities on here, where they went from green, which is weak evidence of problematic conditions, to red in you know, one quarter, it's pretty alarming. And that happened in Calgary this year. You know, in October of 2015, it was green, no signs of problematic commissions. And then, you know, in January, it hit strong. It looks like there's problems. Saskatoon, looks like they've had some overheating in their market. Regina as well. Winnipeg looks like it's getting a little bit better. You look at Canada, we got Victoria. You've green all the way through, so looks like you're pretty good here. Pretty slow and steady. You don't see these peaks and valleys, so nice place to be lending money. We feel it's a lot safer here than some areas. Vancouver also is green. Now, this can be a little bit misleading because we've seen what we would believe is an overheating market in Vancouver for the last 5 years. It just seems to keep going and going and going and going. However, there's certain segments within that market that aren't like that, and I can expand on that a little bit later. Edmonton, same thing. Looks like there's some weakening there, and we're definitely seeing that in the marketplace. So I'm going to tell a little bit about APMIC. This was started back in 2007. It was interesting. It was a conversation I had with one of the other partners. His name was Chess Hagen. He was talking to another one of our other partners and saying, I'm really getting sick of this mutual fund game I'm playing. I invested 8 years ago. I put in $80,000. Every time I talk to my investment advisor, when it drops a little bit, I say, you know, I think I'd like to pull out. He convinces me that, no, we're at the bottom. It's going to come back. This is the worst time to pull out. So I keep it in again. He says, you know, and then I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do it myself. So he went and did the self-directed thing, and he tried to pick his own stocks. And he says, that was a nightmare. I lost everywhere. I was up at night. I hated that. So went and met my dad's neighbor. He's a really, he's a financial planner. He's been doing it a lot of years. He diversified my portfolio in a bunch of different mutual funds, and I still lost money. He says, I don't know what to do. So my other partner, Brad, he says, you know, you should give Steve a call. So he gave me a call, and he says, you know, what should we do? I says, you know what we should do? We should start a MIC. He said, what's a MIC? Mortgage Investment Corporation. Anyways, he did some research, and a little bit later we started. So the first money in the fund was, well, he wasn't the first. He always claims he was the first, but it was my brother with his teacher's pension. He put that in. And then it was Chess, and then a bunch of other friends and family. So this graph does a little bit of a comparison. If you put $100,000 into APMIC back in July of 2008, where it would grow today, and that's the blue line. The red line is the S&P TSX composite, and you can see, I think it was Johanna that had that graph that showed the stock market index. You can see if you had $100,000, it would have dropped right away, and well, we all remember what happened in 08 and 09. Those weren't good years in the stock market, but then it came up, and it bounced around a little bit, came up, and then this last little bit here, it didn't perform so well. And the green line there is the, if you would have just put it at GSE at a 3% return, nice and steady, if you can find a 3% return. So a little bit about our fund. Right now we've got, and this information is from December 31st, a little bit changed right now, but we have $38 million in investment capital from 936 shareholders. So we've grown a little bit from the first days of my brother's $40,000 investment, and Chess's, well, it was 80, went down to 66. By the time he got it out, I think it was 58. And then we also have a line of credit from HSBC, so we lend out about $50 million. The reason we have the line of credit is we always have ebbs and flows. We have borrowers paying their mortgages. We want to lend money out. We always want to keep it pinned. We don't want to have investor capital sitting idly in the bank waiting to fund that next mortgage and only making us 0.05% or whatever they pay us in the savings account. So we try to get it, and also to keep it liquid. Sometimes we get investors who want to get their money back. We do redemptions all the time. Nice thing about a mortgage company is because we're continually lending out mortgages, we have, you know, roughly one or two every week that go out, and one or two every week that pay out. So it's a very liquid fund. There's no reason why, if anybody ever wanted their money back, they couldn't. And I always also get asked, you know, well, what if you're a real large shareholder? Well, our largest shareholder happens to be a mortgage broker. He came in with $4 million. And if he asked for his $4 million at once, we might have a bit of a problem giving it back to him. But other than that, it's very liquid. So our mortgage portfolio, 255 one-year term mortgages. Again, this was from December 31st. And we update our mortgage portfolio every month on our website. We always encourage our investors to come to our website, take a look at what's going on, because it gives you a feel for, you know, where your money is actually invested. So we've got 92.4% in residential. So the lion's share of our mortgages are in residential, and our average loan size is $169,000. The total loan-to-value for the whole fund is sitting at 66%. So I've also been asked, well, how, like, 66%, so that means that your borrowers are borrowing, like, you can go to the bank and borrow up to 80% on a conventional mortgage, and if you use CMHC, you can borrow even higher. That's not the market that we're in. We're not going for that type of market. We're going for the short-term market where people need money for 1 year or less. We also want to have the mortgages at 1 year or less so that when there's changes in the market, like you saw from one of those previous slides where CMHC's data says, well, there's some, looks like there might be some problems in that market that we can also get out. And so our, we call it our monthly fast facts, and you can read, you can see that on our website. So talk a little bit about loan to value. So you saw that we were under 66% loan to value. We have a mix in our mortgage portfolio, a percentage of first and second mortgages. The house on the left-hand side here is a house that has 58% loan to value. So we'll call this house a $100,000 house. $58,000 is the mortgage. 58% is the total amount that that's how we get to our loan to value. The house on the other side there, it has a lower first mortgage, but has a second mortgage behind it. But it's still at 58% loan to value. So at the end of the day, if we ever had a problem with it where we had to foreclose and try to get our money back, as long as our loan to value is low enough, there's usually not a problem in getting money. In fact, we've never lost principal on a foreclosure due to loan to value. Again, this just kind of explains it. Mortgage balance, $100,000, $75,000 loan, $300,000 current home value. Combined loan to value is 58%. So out of our portfolio, we've got in first position, oh shoot, that percentage didn't come up there. We had a little problem formatting these slides, but there was 41% is in second position, and I believe it was 59% was in second position. And then this is our ratio between the two provinces. We're primarily Western Canadian based. We have a little bit in Ontario, but very negligible. It doesn't even show up on the graph. But the lion's share of our mortgages are in British Columbia. This slide's interesting because a couple years ago, it was the exact opposite. We had the lion's share of our mortgages in Alberta. And I've spent 16 years in Alberta. I love that province. But when we saw some things happen there, the drop in the oil price was one of them. The other was the government change. I found it interesting when Gord was talking about how he didn't see house prices continue start to climb again in British Columbia until 2002, 2003. I remember calling that the lost decade in BC. I moved to Alberta because of the lost decade in BC, where we saw just no growth, and it was primarily due to some of the policies of the government at the time. So we're seeing the same thing in Alberta right now. The market is definitely declining. We definitely have moved a lot of our mortgages out of Alberta and back into British Columbia. Foreclosures. We get asked this all the time. Oh, how many foreclosures do you have? Well, right now, as a percentage of our fund, we have 0.18% of in foreclosure. In fact, that was the December 31st data. And our total portfolio loan-to-value was at 68.5%. So if you look at this graph, very small percentage in foreclosure, but we won't lose any money from the foreclosures because the foreclosure is the loan-to-value is so low. We have a lot of room for error in there in case the market does drop in any areas. So it's just simply not to say that in the future it won't happen. We're in the business of lending money. Borrowers don't always come through on their obligations. We definitely have more problem files than we have in foreclosure. And a problem file to us is simply somebody missing a payment, somebody, We'll get an insurance notice that they didn't pay their insurance or whatever. We always put them into the column of the problem file, and then we call the client, how come you missed your payment? Oh, you didn't pay your insurance. No, we got to go pay your insurance, but we don't seldom have many of those problem files go into foreclosure. For it to go into full-blown foreclosure, they have to miss a few payments, not return phone calls, and just disappear off the map. So investing, we accept registered funds, open funds. All distributions are returns on capital. 7% per annum is our targeted distribution. We've never done less than 8. Last year we did 15, but it was a really weird year. We tell everybody, don't ever expect that. The worst was my parents. They're like, oh, we love this. You know, we want to sell something, put some more money in there. I said, don't. It's not, you know, put in what you feel comfortable putting in. 15% was because we had an asset that we acquired through a foreclosure back in 2010, and we were able to sell the asset last year. Felt like it was a good time, and it just really boosted the profit of the fund, but it was not a very normal event. And you can do the dividend reinvestment or get your monthly cash flow, depending on what suits you. Thank you, and I like to open this up to questions because I find the best way to educate people on what we do is to find out what they don't know about us. I wanted to breeze through this as quick as I could because I saw I had the least amount of time, and I know that the mind can only absorb what the butt can endure, so.
I have a question. So I've sold other MICs, and I've never found a MIC that actually paid out the profit on a foreclosure sale. Is that normal?
Sure. Okay, because the foreclosure ended up in us owning the building, we owned and managed the building. In MICs, you're allowed to own up to, I think, 25% in real estate of the balance of your portfolio. We just felt that owning that asset didn't make any sense any longer, so we liquidated it, and we did well with it. I mean, the asset went completely north, and we got to make some money out of it. Go ahead. No, we don't own any assets in the fund whatsoever. Only mortgages now. Go ahead.
I was curious what the minimum is for investing.
Minimum is $10,000. Usually, because we have when you invest through a TFSA or an RSP, there's fees associated with holding that. It just doesn't make any economic sense to put in less. We have accepted open money, so we have some investors who have been investors in the past. They may have the minimum in already, and they say, I only want to top it up by $2,000 this year. That's fine. Sorry.
The distribution you mentioned is considered as a return on capital?
Return on capital. It's T5 income.
So is the 7% you're talking about, if the fund did better, for example, paid you more, would that be considered as capital gain? Or
no, it's all interest income.
Everything's interest.
Absolutely. It's T5 income. It's not partnership income. It's not capital gains. It's all interest. It's to hold this in, it makes sense to hold this in your TFSA, in your RSP. Open money makes less sense because you pay, you're at the highest tax bracket.
What are the management fees?
Management fees are 3%. And that's a factor of what, some MICs will charge 1% and then they'll keep all the lender fees. We don't keep any of the lender fees. We just take 3%, everything goes into the fund in the pool.
Moving forward, do you always focus on West Canada? Or
Western Canada is a market we know and understand. Though we are yield-driven, our biggest concern is return of capital before return on capital. We've seen too many funds play in markets they don't understand, do loans that they didn't know. In fact, early on, we had a fund out of Alberta that actually said, hey, because I lived in Alberta, I just moved back last year, said, hey, you're from the lower mainland, we want to do this deal, and it happened to be in Chilliwack. They said, do you know anything about this? I said, I don't know, what do you want to do? And they wanted to do it. It was more of a commercial loan, and they gave me the appraisal. They said, okay, we've committed to it, the funds are in trust, we just need you guys to help us out with maybe 25% of the loan, we'll share the income. I looked at it, and I said, I know that appraiser, this isn't good. We're not doing it. And they said, no, no, it's great. It's like 30% loan to value. I'm like, you know what? They don't even have their services in. There's no way they're going to get what they're telling you you're going to get. This is a donation. We're just not in. Had we not had the local experience, we wouldn't have known. I mean, they had an AACI appraiser, which is the highest designation you get in Canada from the Appraisal Institute. All the boxes were ticked, but it just, without your local expertise, you just don't know. So we're very careful in areas that we don't know. We understand British Columbia, we understand Alberta, you know, every one of the partners has lived in or done business in the three Western provinces. So we feel very comfortable with the three Western provinces. Beyond that, it would have to be very super safe with some local expertise for us to even consider it. And it wouldn't be a day-to-day thing for us. We'd rather just play where we know. And again, residential is our primary focus. We don't do condos. When I was talking about there's some markets in Vancouver that haven't seen that overinflation. We've seen those, you know, super luxury homes that, you know, 2 years ago were $3 million, now they're $5 million. You know, we just don't play in that market because for us, we don't know how you can really establish a value on that stuff. If that market were ever to dry up, how do you get rid of it? You can't rent it. You can't do anything. So, but there's other pockets in Vancouver where one of our partners, Chess, has a condo in Yale Town. He paid $340,000 for it a decade ago. Well, it's worth $400,000 today. Like, there's certain pockets like that. We get that market. We lend on that stuff. You know, we'll do the $1 million houses in Vancouver, but we won't do the $10 million houses in Vancouver. We'll do the lower end condos. We won't do the higher end condos. Again, primarily we're focused on single family detached. You know, people said, well, it sounds like you want to get out of Alberta completely. No, we don't mind Alberta. We're just careful what we lend on. We're not doing luxury houses in Calgary. We're not doing any houses in Calgary. We're not doing builder loans. We're very concerned about the future absorption. That's just not what we do. Not to say that those loans are always bad. It's just we feel that there's more risk in that area right now than there was before. Saskatoon, Regina, those markets have definitely been very heated in the past. So we just, you know, unless it's a, you know, your typical family home. In fact, we got a deal a while ago in Lethbridge, and I said I love Lethbridge because Lethbridge never saw that big increase. And if it's a single family home and the value is $200,000, and it's a, you know, decent home with a 2,000 square feet, like we know that that's something that if it's not sold, it can be rented. Like there's an exit strategy. If it's a $1.5 million house in Calgary, well, you know, it might be selling for $600,000 today. We just don't know.
How much are you expecting to get on a one-year loan when you lend to
someone? They're all over the map. We've lent, we've done interest rates as low as 6.8% with a 2-point lender fee. We target, you know, we try to target double digits, obviously, to be able to yield what we do. It just depends. The loan to value, like we have a broad spectrum. We have a bunch that are very low loan to value and that are very low yielding, and we have some that are higher loan to value and higher yielding. So it's the overall portfolio generates around 10%, and that includes fees and interest. In fact, another interesting thing, Gordon and I met just over a year ago. We were in Winnipeg, and he was telling me, he says, you know, I've been watching this mixed space, and I've noticed that their yield has been consistently dropping with the bank's yield. I'm like, really? I'd never thought of that before. But then I looked at our own yield, and I was like, he's exactly right. It's done exactly that same thing. So when there's a lower rate environment, it's definitely brings pressure on us to maintain that yield is very tough. We don't want to sacrifice yield for volatility. Like, we're just not interested in chasing yield and going for riskier deals because we can chase a lot higher yield, but then we have to do more developer stuff. We're just not interested. We'd rather, you know, deliver 6% but keep capital preserved than do a higher yield and have to worry about foreclosures and not being able to get all our capital. Our main focus is not on a higher yield. It's on making sure that we're super safe.
All right. Thank you very much. Give a hand for Steve, please. Froze. So we are at the end of our evening. Thank you so much for, did everybody get some sugar wake you up a little bit? Yeah? Okay, before we leave, I I have a stack of expression of interest sheets on every table. If you guys could pass them around and make sure you have one. And I have prizes for filling these out, so you want to make sure you get one. Yeah. So this just helps me to follow up with you in the way that you want me to. So please put your contact information at the top. And then if you are interested in any of these investments or would like to meet with me to speak about some of our other ones, you can check off the top box. And just so you know, I'm not high pressure. Okay, very, very low pressure. So if you want to just meet and talk about your situation and what options are out there, you know, book an appointment. It's a free consultation. We can talk about how Gord Johnson's strategies can work really well for you. And there's so many different ways to do it. So it really is important to meet with you and find out what you're trying to achieve and then the best way to go about that. So if you're interested in that, check off the top one. If you have any RSPs or pension or anything that you're not really happy with or you're scared of a stock market crash and you're interested in diversifying into the private markets, check off that one and we can talk about options. If you're a current investor, I know we have lots of current investors in the room and we haven't met for a while, you just want to do a portfolio review, I recommend doing that regularly. We can talk about how your investments are doing. Of course, if you're interested in turning your mortgage into a pension, which is what tonight was about, check that off. We can discuss that as well. I know last time I did this, people went home with the book and they made the rounds. So it's a great book. Give them to your friends. If you have anybody else that wants, that wasn't able to come and wants the book, I want to thank our two investment companies tonight. They actually sponsored these books. And so you can thank AP Capital and Rev Royalty. Thank you.